Hi, my name is Christoph Junge. I work as a senior portfolio manager for alternative investments. Besides my day job, I teach classes on alternative investments. In this lecture, I'm going to explain what standard deviation is, how it is used in connection with investments, and what some of the pitfalls are, especially in connection with alternative investments. Before we jump into the application of the concept of standard deviation in the financial markets, let's start with a real-world example. There are many data sets outside the financial markets that are normally distributed, or at least close to being normally distributed. This means the distribution looks like a bell curve. Examples could be IQ, or like in this example, height. In this example, we have 16 persons. 3 are 165 centimeters tall, 10 are 175 centimeters tall, and 3 are 185 centimeters tall. The average height, or mean, is 175 centimeters. But what is the standard deviation of the height of this population? And what is standard deviation at all? Standard deviation, denoted by the Greek letter sigma, is a measure of spread around the mean, in the same unit as the mean. So in this case, centimeters. But it could also be percentages, dollars, meters, whatever. Variance, sigma squared, is the average of the squared differences from the mean. And standard deviation is the square root of variance, or variance is standard deviation squared. The reason for taking the squared differences instead of simple differences is that negative and positive differences otherwise would cancel each other out. As you can see in this part of the equation, the first parenthesis is minus 10 centimeters, the next is plus 10 centimeters. The sum of those two would be zero, which would not make any sense. This is why we square it, and then we divide it by n, which is the number of observations, in our case 16. By making this calculation, we find that the standard deviation is approximately 6 centimeters. But what does this tell us? Well, the beauty of a normal distribution is that it is symmetric around the mean. By just knowing the mean and standard deviation, we can say a whole lot about the distribution. For example, we do know that approximately 68% of all observations fall between plus minus one standard deviation from the mean. For example, when analyzing an investment with expected return of 5% and a standard deviation of 10%, we can expect that the 1 year return with a 68% probability is between plus 15 and minus 5%, or even with a 95% probability between minus 15 and plus 25%. In finance, a large standard deviation, which is also called volatility, is being seen as a high-risk investment, while a small standard deviation is often associated with low-risk investments. But it could also mean that standard deviation is not the right measure for this particular investment. We can also calculate the probability of an observation less than X. This is used in the concept of value at risk, which for example states that with a 95% probability we will not lose more than X. But this does not tell anything about how bad it will be when we are on the tail, meaning to the left of the 5% percentile. We would need expected tail loss, or CVAR, conditional value at risk, for that. But the problem in general is that financial data most often is not perfectly normally distributed. In the real world, we observe distributions that are either skewed or have more or less observations in the tails. In the financial markets, we often see fat tails, meaning more extreme observations than we would expect in a normal distribution, especially in the left tail, which are the negative observations, the losses. A distribution with fat tails is called leptokurtic. But also skewness is a huge problem. For example, the distribution of weight in a population is positive skewed. There are some really heavy persons in the right tail, while there is a natural lower bound in the left tail. In the financial world, a positive skew is preferable, as it means some really big gains. Unfortunately, most assets are negatively skewed. An example of moderately positively skewed investments are trend following strategies, where you cut the losses and let the profits run. Examples of negatively skewed investments are unfortunately plenty of, like equities, high yield bonds, or, as a more extreme example, insurance-linked securities. The graph which I have made on the Bloomberg terminal with the command HRH shows the distribution of weekly returns since 1950 for the S&P 500 index. The orange line here indicates the bell curve of a normal distribution. As you can see, there are more observations than expected, both in the middle here, but also in the tails here of the distribution. The weekly standard deviation here, sigma, is 2.05%. We can change the frequency from weekly to monthly by simply multiplying by the square root of 4, as there are 4 weeks in a month, which results in a 4.1% monthly standard deviation. This monthly standard deviation can be transformed into a yearly number by multiplying by the square root of 12, giving us a yearly standard deviation of 14.2%. Even though this distribution does not follow a normal distribution, it is actually quite close. Close enough, at least, that many financial models rely on the assumption of normally distributed returns. A more extreme example is this. It shows the monthly returns of the Eureka Hedge ILS Advisor Index. ILS stands for insurance-linked securities, which are contracts where the payoff is subject to the occurrence or non-occurrence of catastrophes, like for example hurricanes or earthquakes. The average monthly return, the mean, is 36 basis points or 0.36%, and a monthly standard deviation, sigma, of 0.97% or close to 1%. It can be clearly seen in the picture that this distribution is far from following the orange bell curve. Let us, for the sake of simplicity, assume that the average return is 0%. 99.7% of all observations should be between plus minus 3 standard deviations from the mean. So in this case, between minus 3% and plus 3%. The first red circle, this one here, indicates observations that are at minus 3.55% and minus 3.85%, while this red circle here shows losses of close to 9%, a 9 sigma event, which is quite unusual. But as I already mentioned, the returns are not normally distributed, and a standard deviation is clearly not the correct measure of risk for a skewed return profile like that from ILS, where a fairly low volatility gives the impression of low risk. And every once in a while, we have a huge drawdown, like this 9 sigma event. This return profile comes actually very close to the strategy of option selling. Standard deviation would also understate the true risk here. Another problem with alternative investments is that we do not have observable market prices, and therefore many return series rely on quarterly appraisals or model valuations. These tend to have a high degree of serial correlation or autocorrelation and a fairly low volatility as well, which masks the true risk. This is the case in infrastructure, timberland, real estate and private equity. I hope you enjoyed this lecture on standard deviation and its application in finance. Please visit my personal homepage to learn more about my course, and please leave a comment if you like. Thanks for watching.